Greetings, fellow gorehounds, and welcome back to a Blood Splatter vlog. I'm the Horror Guru, and today I'm going to talk about Brandon Cronenberg's latest film, Possessor. Now, for those of you who don't know, Brandon Cronenberg is the son of one David Cronenberg, and made a film back in 2012 called Antiviral, which was fucking phenomenal. And back then, when that film came out, many people, myself included, stated that it felt like Brandon Cronenberg was kind of taking the torch that his father left behind back in the 80s, making a film that was equal parts science fiction, psychological thriller, body horror, and on top of all that, filling it with so much social commentary that people are still talking about that movie to this day and all the layers of meaning it had. So naturally, given that Possessor is his follow-up film to Antiviral, it comes in with a whole lot of expectations heaped upon it by people like myself. And I gotta be honest, that is a hard position to be in if you're a filmmaker and you come out swinging right off the bat with your first film being fucking phenomenal, because now your second film has so much to live up to, the chances of it actually reaching it are extremely low, no matter how talented you are. But with that all being said, I am happy to report that Possessor 100% lives up to every expectation I had and so much more. And much like Antiviral, this film is also a science fiction psychological thriller with a little bit of body horror thrown in and a lot, and I mean a lot, of social commentary. Seriously, no joke, I watched this movie like a couple weeks ago and I've been sitting here chewing on it ever since, and so I decided, why not actually throw on my camera and do a vlog on it, because I gotta get my thoughts out there somehow. So, with all that being said, let us finally talk about Possessor and what it's all about. The basic premise of this film is like something out of a cyberpunk novel. It's about a corporate assassin who basically assassinates people by jacking into her targets and taking over their bodies and then making them commit suicides or murder suicides, as the case may be. And while this job compensates our main character very well, it comes with a very unfortunate caveat, and that's this. The more she carries out these assassinations, the more of herself she loses in these people that she injects herself into. She loses a little bit of who she is every time she carries out a job, and as a result of this, it starts to affect her home life. Because how the hell can her loved ones love her for who she is if they don't even know who she is, and more than that, she doesn't even know who she is. And yeah, there's a whole lot more that happens in the movie that I'll get to when we get to the spoilers, but that's the basic idea, the basic struggle of what the main character goes through over the course of this film. And that core struggle is incredibly compelling for a multitude of reasons, not the least of which being, it's actually low-key relatable. Like, just take a moment to think about it. Think about whatever job you do on your day-to-day, whether it be working retail or an office job or something a little more hands-on. Now imagine who you are when you do that job. Are you really yourself, or are you the person that job requires you to be? For example, say you're working retail and you're having to interface with customers, and even though you're having a bad week and you're feeling shitty, you still have to put a smile on your face and act like you want to help these people, even though on most days you just kind of want to strangle them. Every job to a certain extent has some element of this to it. Even my job as a YouTuber. I turn on this camera, I record these vlogs or my Blood Splattered Cinemas, and I put on a performance. It's an exaggerated version of myself, to be clear, but I'm still performing for the camera, being someone else for your entertainment, even if it's a slightly exaggerated version of who I really am. But that person, the person smiling for the customers, or the person sitting right here performing to you, is not one-to-one the same person when I'm just hanging with my friends, or hanging with my girlfriend. There's two or more competing identities that exist within every given worker, and who they are, who you are, who I am, depends entirely upon what the circumstances require from us. And what I fucking love about this film is that even though it's a heightened reality and we're dealing with an assassin and not, say, a wage slave, is that it not only explores that duality, it also explores what happens when the lines get blurred and you no longer know which one is the real you. Essentially, the situation where you've been working so goddamn hard that your work identity is now consuming your home identity to the point where you're not even sure who that person is anymore, or how to be that person properly around the people you're normally that person with. And here's the crazy thing. That's just one element of this movie. There are so many other aspects that can be explored and chewed and digested, and I just sat here for the whole opening of this video talking about just one, and I'm still not done talking about it. But for the sake of time, I will save the rest of my thoughts on that for the spoiler section and move on to other elements of the film. Anyway, one thing I want to stress is that even if you don't want to explore the movie on that deep a level, there is still, on the surface, a whole lot of exciting shit that goes down in this film. We're talking graphic violence and body horror, corporate espionage plots, doomed love, psychedelic mindfuck sequences, and surprisingly some really good sci-fi world building, which is also an element I really liked about Antiviral. In fact, I would not be surprised if they existed in the same universe, because they kind of feel like they do. I do, however, want to issue one warning to anyone who decides to check this film out because of this vlog, and that's this. Possessor is not exactly a film that handholds its audience. There's very little, if any, exposition explaining to you at any given time what's happening. You're gonna have to piece it together based on what they're showing you. It's a film that really takes show don't tell to its heart, and if you're not paying close attention, you might get lost really easily. Because even scenes where characters are exploring their own feelings, they never outright say what they're feeling. You have to figure it out based on what they're not saying. So if you're not used to that kind of film, then be prepared to pay extra attention going in. But honestly, I don't think most of you are gonna have trouble with that, because this is a pretty crazy film. Every other scene demands your goddamn attention by having something nuts happen. So you're gonna wanna watch it, you're gonna wanna see what happens next, and enjoy the what the fuck ride. Anyway, I think I've exhausted everything I could say without spoiling the movie, so needless to say, I fucking love Possessor, and I highly recommend you check it out on whatever service you can find that's playing it. And while I'm at it, I also recommend you check out Antiviral if you haven't done that yet, because these two movies go really well together, even though they're separate stories. But if you've already seen one or both of those films, leave a comment below letting me know what you thought of Antiviral or Possessor. And with that said, let us finally move on to the spoilers. Alright, so this movie opens up with the main character in the middle of a job, but upon trying to complete it, something goes terribly wrong. You see, she's supposed to kill herself at the end of the job, but her host body won't let her. It won't pull the trigger. So she has to commit suicide by cop instead. And because the job wasn't supposed to go down like that, she ends up undergoing a psychological evaluation by her superior, where we find out her own grip on her own memories has been starting to falter something fierce. But it's also really obvious it goes a lot deeper than just her memories, but she keeps that close to her chest because she doesn't want to compromise her job. And I really love this detail, because think about any job you've ever had, and think about every time you had to hide the fact that you were tired, or that you were sick, or that you were just having a shitty day, because you were worried that giving the boss any indication that you might be slowing down, or that you might need time off, or anything that shows anything other than productivity, that you might lose the job itself. Again, even though this movie is a hyper-real science fiction assassination scenario, it's still 100% relatable to everyone sitting at home. And I also love the subtle way the movie clues us in to the main character having trouble remembering who she is at home. Because we get a scene really early on where she's like on her way home, and she's like reciting what she's gonna say to her husband like it's a script. And then later on in the movie, when she takes another job, she does the same thing to get in character for the person who she's gonna inject herself into. Essentially demonstrating whether she's at work or at home, she's ultimately engaging in a performance. And just in case you think I was reading way too much into the parallels between real wage slavery and the work she does and the weird identity crisis that it creates in The Worker, the movie itself low-key makes the parallel on its own through the job that she takes that kicks off the plot. basically, she is hired to inject herself into this one guy who is on the verge of marrying the daughter of this rich billionaire. A rich billionaire played by Sean Bean, by the way.
One does not simply live through a movie.
And her job is to commit murder-suicide using this guy's body, killing both the billionaire and the daughter. But here's the thing. The guy she injects herself into is not a higher-up in the company. He's one of the lower-rung wage slaves. And the movie goes out of its way to show us the main character having to live a life in the day of this guy. And thus having to go to this shitty job and having to be a different person than he normally is because she now has to be his work self. These scenes and this subplot also introduces additional themes to the movie involving classism. Because you have this low-class guy working this shitty dead-end job, and he's marrying into a rich family, and when they have to go and meet the billionaire, the main character in the guy's body has to pretend to be the version of him that acts differently at his future father-in-law's gatherings. Now you have the job at work and who you are there, you have you at home, you have you meeting the parents, and then you have you in a higher class society than you are used to. And again, I must stress that all these elements are being explored within the confines of a science fiction psychological thriller slash horror film with a bunch of body horror and a corporate espionage assassination plot. There's so much going on in this movie, I don't think I have the time to talk about it all. But hopefully you've been following me so far. Anyway, what follows in the movie is you have the attempted assassination plot, you have the main character losing control of the body she's in, the identity of the guy starting to take over again, you have a complete mindfuck of a sequence in which the guy is trying to take over his own body and she is trying to take it back, and there's like this dream sequence going on in which they're like hallucinating a whole bunch of shit. A whole bunch of people die in the process of all this. Which means the second half of this movie largely consists of the main character literally battling with another personality in one body. And naturally, this literal struggle parallels the metaphorical struggle within her, trying to figure out who she is. Is she work person? Is she home person? Or is she someone else entirely? And the movie ultimately culminates in her having to make that decision, but does she actually make the decision? Is it her, or is it the guy inside her, or is it the corporate overlords that want her to do specific things because they don't want to lose their best assassin? And just so you know, I'm about to spoil my favorite part of the movie, which is the very ending, so if you don't want that spoiled, if you haven't watched the movie yet, stop right here, pause, go watch the movie, come back, and then finish this vlog from this point forward. So I've already alluded to what metaphorically happens at the end of this movie, but now let me tell you what literally happens. The guy she jacked into temporarily regains control of his body, and with her memories, tracks down where her family is, pulls a gun on her husband, or her ex-husband to be more accurate, and demands that the ex-husband tell him what the fuck is going on. Except the ex-husband has no idea what his wife does for work, he just assumes she has a high-end corporate job. So you have this super tense sequence where he's demanding something the ex-husband can't possibly give him, while she is trying to regain control of the body so that he won't kill her ex-husband, who she still kind of low-key loves. And goddamn, my fellow gorehounds, this whole sequence was intense as fuck. My heart was racing like crazy. I was on the edge of my seat, and I was just, oh my god, don't kill this guy, he's innocent, please don't. And then I realized, oh shit, she also has a kid, don't kill the kid, please. And ultimately, the way this scene ends up concluding is the husband ends up dead, and the guy in the body ends up shooting the kid, killing the kid. And oh my god, the way this movie depicts this sequence, when it doesn't show the guy in the body shooting the kid, it shows it as if she's the one killing the kid, and you're left wondering, was it her? Was it him? Either way, you can see the devastation going on in her eyes when the kid drops dead, and oh man, my fucking heart in that moment. And then there's a twist. And that twist is, it turns out her boss from the beginning of the movie, who's been trying to contact her throughout the film, has injected herself into the kid and basically orchestrated a sequence so that the kid would end up dead. And now that the husband's dead, her home identity is now gone and she can fully commit herself to the corporate assassin life. And this ultimately culminates in her having another psychological debrief scene. And it appears that all her struggles, her dual identity, her lost memories, that's not an issue anymore, because now she knows who she is, and that's a cold-blooded corporate killer. And oh my god, is this fucking bleak, but isn't it also, like, realistic? Like, just think about it for a second and remove the assassin part from the equation. How many jobs leave their workers these soulless husks that don't have any time for a home life anyway, and demand that they commit themselves wholly and fully to that job, with said jobs requiring people to be a little ruthless, because at the end of the day, here in America, profit is king. And again, leaving the assassin part out of the equation, how is the way the main character is left at the end of this movie any different than what any given wage slave job is pushing people to be? Whoa. Just holy shit, guys. This movie left me fucking devastated. It's bleak as fuck. It has a lot to say. There's a lot to chew on, and I can't recommend it enough. With that said, my fellow gorehounds, be sure to like, comment, and subscribe. Don't forget to ring that notification bell so that you're notified of my videos immediately upon their upload. And if you'd like to help out my channel more directly, then be sure to check out my Patreon page. And remember, if you decide to go the Patreon route, even $1 a month can go a long way. And with all that said, my fellow gorehounds, hopefully now that I've made this vlog, I can start thinking about other movies, because goddamn did thinking about this one take up a whole bunch of my time. And, with that said, peace out, my fellow gorehounds, and I'll catch y'all later.